Welcome, 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 welcome to Making the Shift to allow more authentic student choice. I'm Eric Scott. I am an educator and an artist. I live in Northern Virginia, just right outside of Washington, D.C. And I'm so excited that you chose to join in, to watch in, to tune in to this talk that's all about making the shift. So many of you might be thinking like, oh, I wanna have more student choice. I've been hearing about choice-based art education, or I've been hearing about TAB, teaching for artistic behavior. And maybe you have some questions, maybe you have some concerns. And this is just sort of to give a little bit of an overview, but kind of think about kind of what your core beliefs are for your classroom and for your teaching, and to kind of give you some ideas of how you might start to make that shift. This can't be an all-encompassing kind of talk, but I can kind of give you some strategies that you can go back to your classroom and use right away. But I want to start off with telling you kind of my story about how I came to be here. So I grew up in southwestern Pennsylvania, just south of Pittsburgh, outside of a city called Washington. And I loved art. So I never remember a time when I wasn't making art. So probably around, you know, age two or whatever, I picked up a pen, pencil, crayons, markers, started drawing, probably drawing on the wall, you know, just as any little kid does. But I just never stopped. And so 40 some years later, here I am. I'm an artist and an educator, but I've just, you know, I've spent this, my life, basically drawing, painting, cutting, gluing. I'm a mixed media artist, but I have experience with lots of different things. And when I thought about what I wanted to do with my life when I was going through high school, I thought like, oh, I want to be, well, at first I thought I wanted to be an architect, but then I thought like, oh, art teacher, that sounds good, because I really enjoyed working with my fellow students and doing some tutoring. And I thought that might be really interesting to kind of help people and share my art with folks. And so I went to Edinburgh University of Pennsylvania, got a Bachelor's of Science in Art Ed, and then took a year off, and eventually I started teaching. And I spent 20 years teaching in public schools. And there were things about it that I absolutely loved. I loved working with students. I loved like when the, you know, those light bulb moments when the kids just sort of lit up and really got what I was after. But there's just so much with public school teaching that I just couldn't deal with anymore. And most of it was like all the extra stuff that we as teachers have to kind of deal with. So I left teaching. Well, I left public school teaching. I'm still a teacher. I'm still an educator. I teach at a local art center. I teach kids. I teach adults. I travel and teach a lot as well. And during that time, I really grew as not just an artist, but as an educator. And with 20 some years, where right now it's about 25 years of teaching experience and over 45 years of making art, I've come to realize that there really is a very simple truth for me. And this is the core of my teaching. And it wasn't always that way. So probably many of you are familiar with that idea of having a philosophy of education. And that was something that was like touched upon in my education classes back at Edinburgh. But it wasn't something that I ever did. I mean, I never sat down and I never had to write a philosophy. And so I went into teaching, and discipline-based art education was the big thing. I mean, I learned that in college, and then the districts that I worked in, that was like the big push that they were doing. And that's what they encouraged. And you know, when we had professional development and that kind of stuff. And so I never really had my own philosophy, and I just sort of went along with this notion. And I think a lot of people think of, when they think of discipline-based art ed, they think about like, oh, I have this artist and I have this project. So if I say something like Chuck Close portraits or Van Gogh Starry Night paintings or Matisse cutouts, you know, those start to conjure up projects. And, you know, looking at Pinterest, looking at social media, you can still see that there's a lot of that out there. And what I started to discover, and part of this was because I was an artist, was that I started discovering that like having these projects really wasn't about creativity, even though that was part of my assessment. I mean, I had the three C's: craftsmanship, composition, and creativity. And then by the time I was finishing up my teaching career, public school teaching career, I had the five C's. So I had like craftsmanship, composition, creativity, concept, and commitment. That's what it was, commitment. So that way I could kind of assess engagement in the project. And that's the thing, the project. But what I found is that there wasn't much room for the student's creativity. And I even had a student one year, like one of my first years teaching, come up to me. We were teaching a project and they asked me like, oh, can I draw such and such? And I was like, well, no. And they looked at me kind of like disheartened. And I was like, well, that's not part of the project. The project is this. And then I realized I felt really bad. Like I saw the disappointment on the student's face and, you know, they kind of dropped their head and trudged back to the table and did what they were told to do. And I that started me thinking like there has to be a different way of doing that. And so after all this time, I've really come to believe that everyone is uniquely creative, that has become my core value. And really, if I think about my philosophy of education, that's what it boils down to. So at the beginning of my career, I never had a philosophy. And then as I taught, I started realizing like, if I'm making all the choices, then I'm really taking something away from the students and I'm not allowing them and their voice to come out in their art. And that's the thing, it's their art. If I'm making all the choices, then it's my project, not theirs. So that's kind of a real shortened version of my story, my journey to this point. And now I want you to think about your story. So what is your story? Think about your story about teaching. And then think about the story that you're kind of telling yourself about choice and about choice-based education or about TAB, teaching for artistic behaviors. So your teaching tells a story. So what is that story? So try to imagine yourself as an outside observer coming in and looking at your displays, looking at the way you teach. Are you the type that is really allowing choice? Are you doing more of a directed kind of thing? Is it very directed where everyone's kind of doing the exact same thing and, you know, you're showing them I'm doing this step and now we're going to do this step. So what is that telling you? Like if you're directing that, what's the story? Do you believe that everyone is creative and that everyone should kind of have that freedom to explore that? Oftentimes I think whenever I look around at classrooms and at displays and hallways, that the story that I get is that number one, that like teachers are really trying to impress parents and administrators and fellow teachers, because, the artwork looks good. Oh, look, check this out. You get compliments about like, oh, that's awesome artwork you have out there in the hall. Are you thinking about like, oh, well, kids really need the structure. And so, they can't handle the choice and I have to really have the steps out so they can learn to follow directions. Or is it very kind of like egocentric, like you want to be perceived as a good teacher? It's like, look how great I am. Look what I can get the students to do. So is it really about your ego and yourself, or is it about the students? And so are you trying to be Pinterest perfect so that you can post all over social media and show these awesome projects? Or are you really there for the students to really get them to connect with art in a personal way and not just copying and imitating somebody else or doing somebody else's project. And I think that kind of ties into what you think about for choice. So what is the story that you have in your head about choice-based education or TAB? Or, you know, a lot of times what I find is that a lot of folks think that choice-based is chaos, that it's kids running around just doing whatever they want, throwing stuff, breaking materials, mistreating things, making a mess. And it's also about like the teachers giving up total control and that, you know, students aren't learning anything. So is that your story? Or do you have a story that can kind of be like, well, I can allow students to have choice and have an authentic voice in their work. And I can create structure. I can create an environment where this is possible and that it's not a free for all and materials aren't being wasted. And I am teaching to the standards, because that's another thing that comes up a lot. Folks are always like, well, you know, how do you make sure that they're learning stuff? And, you know, on social media, I see a lot of back and forth about like teachers like, oh, well, you know, when the kids are just left to like for free expression, they're not learning the basics. And I'm like, well, even teachers that are teaching the basics, kids aren't getting it because it doesn't resonate with them. You know, that idea of drill and kill just doesn't work. Kids don't remember that. They remember it if they learn it in a different way, if they are invested in it, if it resonates with them. So I think like whatever your story is, you know, we can kind of take a look at Bloom's taxonomy. And this is something that back in 2001 was revised. And I think a lot of artists and a lot of art educators rejoiced because, hey, creates at the very top. And so like, oh, my kids are always creating, but we forget that the word create also means to make. And so, yes, you can be creating something, making something, but it might not be an original thing. And so if we are making all the choices for the kids and giving them a project, they're really never getting above like that apply level. I mean, we're asking them to, okay, I want you to remember who Van Gogh is, and I want you to understand how we're doing the crayon resist, and I want you to draw with crayon first, and you have to understand to press hard. So you apply that to your picture. Now you have to paint over it so that the paint is watery enough where it doesn't stick to the crayon. And so are they really getting up to that creating level? Are they evaluating anything? Are they analyzing anything? Or are they just understanding the directions and then following through? And if they're just following through, then they're just applying. They never get to that top level. But if a student is creating their own projects, they have to analyze, they have to evaluate, because they have to think like, what's the best way to do this? What is the best materials to use? What's the best technique for this? A lot of times they're problem solving. And so they have to analyze, what is the problem? How am I going to solve this? Evaluate different solutions to that problem, and then to create what they are wanting to create. And that's actually how artists work. At least that's how I work as an artist. And that's where a lot of this came from for me, was that, yes, as an artist, I'm making stuff, but I have to choose. I have to come up with that. And I know a lot of folks are like, oh, well, but, you know, as a professional artist, like, yeah, you've learned how to do that. But for students, we have to really kind of rein them in and guide them and teach them the basics. And the thing is, you can still do that. You can still teach them basics, but you're just not dictating the directions to them. You're allowing them to find their own direction. So if you find that you are thinking about making the shift and you want to have more choice, more authentic voice in your classroom, in your studio, you might be thinking like, well, how do I do that? And there's a lot of great resources out there, but I'm going to give you some simple strategies that you can take back immediately to your classroom and try it out. So how can you make this shift without all those kind of negative stories that you've been telling yourself about choice and about chaos and about free-for-all and about kids breaking stuff? And how can you keep that from kind of coming true? how can you structure your environment? Because that's the thing, you are the teacher, you are creating the environment for them to thrive in. And if it's chaos, all this madness kind of stuff, then that's because of the way you structured things. And so one of the things to kind of keep in mind is that with choice-based approaches is that there's kind of this back and forth. So it's not always like kids just doing whatever they want all the time. It's about teachers saying, oh, let me show you something. Let me introduce a new material. Let me talk about the safety precautions of this. And so there are times whenever you as a teacher are leading demonstrations, showing them how to use materials, talking about composition, talking about how artists develop ideas. You're still teaching those things, but it's not like this structured thing where everyone's making the same project. So maybe you do projects. Maybe you're like, oh yeah, I'm that discipline-based art ed teacher and I want to make that shift. Or you might think like, I have these projects that I got from Pinterest or I got from social media. And how do I start to open up my practice? Well, first of all, I'd say you have to have that core belief. So my core belief if everyone is uniquely creative, what can I do to help facilitate that, help each individual student tap into their creativity? Because we're uniquely creative, right? So I might have an interest in one thing and you have an interest in another and somebody else has an interest in something else, and we all bring something different to this environment. So if we're all doing the exact same thing, then some of us aren't really going to be engaged. So how can you open this up? So first of all, I'd say start where you are. Don't throw everything out. I know some folks get so excited. They're like, oh, I'm just going to like go full throttle and I'm going to dive into the deep end and I'm going to like just throw everything out and I'm going to start, you know, fresh and new. And then it becomes overwhelming. And I think that's where that chaos, the free-for-all comes from, is that sometimes we get into something and we don't fully understand how we as a teacher create the environment, and that there are ways that we could still have structure, but also have freedom. And that's kind of an interesting concept. And sometimes it's a little bit difficult, like, well, how can you have structure and freedom? Well, just the way that we have laws in our country and we have freedoms, right? So it's kind of like that. But I think you have to start where you are and thinking about, well, what is the core value? I mean, if you just don't believe that students can handle choice, yeah, you're going to maybe subconsciously prove yourself right if you try. You know, you're going to be that self-fulfilling prophecy that, oh yeah, choice is just a free-for-all and I tried it and this is what happened. And it's like, well, you're the teacher, so you can structure it. But if you don't believe it, then it's really not going to work out. So anyway, you know, how can you kind of take the projects that you do and drop the project? So that's kind of what I think is a good place to start. So you take your project. So you might take a Van Gogh sunflower project that you do with your third graders. And you might say, okay, well, what if I dropped the project? Instead of having them imitate Van Gogh and make sunflower, evasive sunflowers like Van Gogh did, what if we talked about how Van Gogh looked around his room, his house? You know, he walked outside, or so you could look at that and say, oh, he painted things in his environment. He looked around and found little things like flowers. So what if you had students like, okay, I want you to look around this classroom. Let's find inspiration in this classroom. So every student ends up picking something different, but then they are the ones that are choosing. So you start to open that up. So you drop that idea of a project. You could still teach materials. You can still teach technique, but just allowing them to decide what they're going to make, that's a step into that direction. That's a step into making that shift. I always think of that old adage, like, you know, you can please some of the people all the time and all the people, however it goes, I can't remember it. I've taken that and put a little spin on it because of students. I always think about projects and student engagement and student motivation. So, you know, you can motivate all the students some of the time and some of the students all the time, but you can't motivate all the students all of the time. Because I mean, think about it, like anytime you do a project, are all the kids engaged? Now you might say like, oh yeah, but I can get them all successful. I can get them through. But you know, you have those kids that it's like pulling teeth, you know, because they're not engaged in it. They're not motivated to do it. They do it because you're telling them or there's a grade attached to it. So, you know, can you get engagement with choice? I mean, yeah, I think you're going to get more engagement because students are choosing what they are doing. So starting where you are, but dropping the project and thinking like, okay, I can still have an artist. I can still have materials. I can still teach technique, but I'm just not going to have this expectation that they're going to imitate or emulate the artist. And I think that ties into my next sort of strategy. My next idea is the big ideas. So big ideas are themes, ideas, concepts. They're broad human issues or concerns that artists often are exploring. So they're going to take a look at identity or memory or place or conflict or struggle or whatever. I mean, there's an infinite amount of big ideas, but a lot of times you can look at the artwork and you can figure out big ideas. So big ideas tie so well into that idea of dropping the project. And so instead of emulating the work of an artist, you are being inspired. So students are taking the themes, the subjects, the materials, and they're being inspired by it. And then you're helping them kind of see or develop ideas. So that's the other thing is like, you know, students don't naturally know how to develop ideas, especially if they're always told what to do. So, you know, you might get a group in middle school and you're like, oh, we tried this. You know, I always think back to hearing folks talk about like, you know, students are always talking or asking like, when do we get to make our art? When do we get to do kind of a free project, what we want to do? And so the teacher turns around and lets them do it. And the kids just sit there. They don't know what to do. And that's because, well, if you've spent your entire academic career, if you've spent 5, 6, 7 years being told exactly what to do and how to do it, then you don't have the confidence to try your own. Some kids will. Some kids will just naturally do that. But a lot of kids by then will have shut down. So even you think about like, well, you know, first grade, you know, I find like with kindergartners and first graders that they're more open to it. But if you come in and maybe you're a new teacher in a new school, or maybe you're just kind of changing things up, you know, your fourth and fifth graders who've had you for years and they're used to projects, they're going to have a hard time. You're going to have to slowly lead them to it. So big ideas are a great way of doing that because you can start to teach the students, like, how do artists come up with ideas? Well, one of the ways they do that is big ideas. And so I want to share a story that if you've ever seen any of my other talks, you might have heard this one before, but it's about Hokusai. So, you know, we can think of Hokusai's The Great Wave. And I was talking to a good friend of mine who's a fellow art teacher, and he talked about this Hokusai project that he had. And we were talking about choice. And he's like, oh, I give my kids a choice, you know, in this Hokusai, you know, they don't have to make 3 boats. They can make 1 boat or 10 boats. And I'm like, is that really? Yeah, that's a choice, but is that a real like authentic choice? So, you know, sometimes we think like, oh yes, I'm giving them choices, but it's like, well, yeah, you're basically like, they can pick whatever colors they want to make the vase of the sunflower, you know, for the sunflower picture that they're making about Van Gogh. But is that really an authentic choice? So if we take a look at Hokusai, we can think about like, well, you know, that's part of a series. Was it the 26 or 36 views of Mount Fuji, right? So it's about looking at this landmark in Japan that you can really see from lots of different areas and, you know, miles away. It's a huge landmark and he's using it as inspiration. So it's the artist and his environment. And he's looking at that work and he's creating this series, exploring this big landmark. So, you know, I was talking to my friend and I said, what if you had your kids think about their environment, like, you know, where they live and, you know, their school and their community, and what are landmarks that they know? And he kind of scratched his head and he said, yeah, but, you know, I'd probably get a lot of like strip malls and townhouse developments and suburban kind of things. And I'm like, well, yeah, it's because that's where they live. And so there's still inspiration to be had in even that environment. And so why are you having them draw Mount Fuji whenever they have no concept of Mount Fuji, other than maybe they've seen it in pictures, or maybe some of them have actually gone there, but probably not many. So big ideas, you know, the environment, the conflict, you know, identity, memory, place, all these things can be used to help the students develop their own ideas. And it ties so well in. Again, you can have a project. So you could take that Van Gogh project and think about like, oh, Van Gogh, yes, his environment, but he wasn't looking at landmarks. He was looking at ordinary things, ordinary people. So he was painting his mailman. He was painting sunflowers, you know. So looking at objects around you and finding inspiration, the big ideas. Another way to encourage choice is through experimenting and play. So experiments are great because it's play and it's exploration. Now, there's a lot of research out there about how great play is for learning, that kids learn so much just through play. And actually, as an artist, that's how I've learned to use most of the materials that I use. So I didn't have a teacher showing me, this is how you do your mixed media artwork. I had to figure that out. And so the materials that I had, you know, when I started using them, some of them I had never used, and I had to figure out how to use them. What were the ways of doing that? And this was kind of like before the internet was such a big thing, and I just couldn't do a quick search and find lots of videos about how to use these materials. Nowadays we can look at YouTube and really figure anything out, see how to do almost anything. But giving kids the time and the permission to play and explore, it's a great way for them to learn about the materials, learn what works, what doesn't work, learn how to do something. They learn kind of like, they're going to discover new things. They're going to discover new ways of doing something. And oftentimes that's great to do, because what happens is the kids discover things that you wouldn't actually teach them. And, you know, so you might think about like, if we take watercolor, for instance, we might just show them three or four different basic watercolor techniques, but then they might discover a whole new way of using watercolors that you didn't think of. It's maybe not an official technique. You know, it's not in a book, it's not online, it's something that they developed. I'll give you a couple of examples of this. So clay is something where, you know, oh, I don't have, you know, oftentimes you know, kids get to use clay one time a year because, you know, it has to be dried and fired and glazed or painted and all this stuff. It's a big to-do. It's expensive. So what I would often do is give the students modeling clay, plasticine clay, and be like, okay, just make something. You know, they each get a chunk of it, make something. All right, make whatever you want. All right, ball it up, make something else. And we do that for 15 minutes, 20 minutes. Just make something, squish it up, make something else. Squish it up, make something else. And so what they're doing is they're experimenting, they're playing, they're exploring, they're trying out different things. They're figuring out like what they can make out of it without me saying, this is how you do this. And now you might say, oh, but that's just the kids playing around. They're not learning anything. Well, yes, they are learning. They're learning a lot, actually. And actually, they're learning more than you think. So what I would do is near the end of class, you know, have them work with this. Then I would stop them and be like, all right, now describe to me what you did with the clay, not what you made. Don't tell me that you made a tree or an animal or a car or whatever. Tell me how you use clay. What did you do to the clay? And so I'll hear somebody say, oh, I squished it. Well, what do you mean? How did you squish it? Well, I put it on the table and I pressed it down. Ah, you flattened it. That's called a slab. You're making a slab, you're flattening it, you're making the pancake. so I'm tying it to that technique of slabbing. And I could say, you know, we have rolling pins if you want it to be really flat, right? Or we have machines and, you know, the slab roller, maybe if you're teaching upper level kids. And, you know, what else did you do? Oh, I rolled it. Well, what do you mean you rolled it? I rolled it into a ball. Oh, anybody else roll it a different way? Oh, I rolled it into a snake. Ah, we call that a coil. So you rolled a coil. You know, you can make a coil pot. You can use that to create different parts of an animal. You can use this in lots of different ways. So we go through that. And, you know, eventually they name all the basic clay techniques. Now they don't talk about scoring and slipping, but that's something that I can demonstrate when it's time to use the ceramic clay. And so that way they've shown me like, oh, you can use the clay, you can make it. And the plasticine is much harder than regular clay. So, or ceramic clay. So it's going to help them build up those hand muscles, those finger muscles. And it's going to help them whenever it comes time to kind of deciding what they want to make out of clay. So yes, I still have to teach them how to score and slip. I have to talk about, you know, having things too thick, maybe hollowing things out. And, you know, so there's still more I have to teach them about clay, but they know the basics and they got to experiment and they got to play with it. And I was talking about how students can discover new things. I did a project with paper and they were using paper, just, you know, flat sheets of paper and paper straws. And one group, I had them working in groups, they developed a technique that they called kebobbing. And just by saying that, you could probably imagine it. So what they did was they pierced each piece of paper and stuck this paper straw through it. And so they were able to have these pieces of paper on that straw. And I wrote that up as one of the techniques that they could use as they were creating their sculptures, kebobbing. And so, you know, they discovered a new thing. I added up. And when they came in the next class, they're like, hey, we came up with that. It's like, yeah, you did. And it was a great idea. So experimenting, play, exploration, a great way to get students to try different things with materials, discover new ways of using things. And it gives them some practice before diving into a bigger, more finalized project. And so for some kids, that's all they need. You know, some kids will do the modeling clay and be like, okay, I don't need to do ceramic clay. And I don't make them do it if they don't want to. So anyway, so another way of kind of engaging students and making the shift is thinking about this notion of challenges. So giving students problems to solve, not directions to follow. And I think this is really important because challenges, we're setting limitations for the kids. We're saying, okay, you know, I want you to make, you know, a colorful painting using just the primary colors. You know, now this is not a project. This is something that might be a one day thing or a half a class kind of thing. It's a way to get them to engage in making something, but you're giving them some limitations. So it might be, you know, using shapes. I want you to draw only three circles and four rectangles and three straight lines. And, you know, and then, okay, what can you make out of that combination of shapes and lines? And, you know, try different variations. What if you do five different ones? It only takes you a couple minutes. And so these limitations, I think, are pretty essential because, you know, going back to that idea of, you know, kids not knowing what they want to do when you finally give them the freedom to do their own project or to free draw, and they sit there and they're like, oh, I can't think of anything. Well, it's because they haven't learned to put limitations. They have too many choices, too many ideas, and they don't know how to limit it. So giving them the limitations can help teach them to create their own limitations later. Because I love this quote by psychologist Rollo May, creativity itself requires limitations, for the creative act arises out of the struggle of human beings with and against that which limits them. And so if we give them limitations and teach them how to create their own eventually down the road, then we open up their creativity. And I always think about like kids breaking rules. If you want to see how creative kids can get, think about how kids go about breaking rules and pushing up against the rules. I always think about when I taught high school art And at the time, kids weren't allowed to have to use their cell phones. They weren't allowed to have music players. And this was before the wireless earbuds. And so they would find these like creative ways to hide the fact that they were listening to music. And they would run the wire up their sleeve. They would put their hand over, you know, girls would like put their hair down over the wire. And, you know, they'd find all these creative ways of pushing against these limits. And so that's what the challenges do. It gives them limitations like, okay, here's your limit. Here's your limitations. What are you going to do within that, those limitations? And I'm not going to dictate every step. I'm not giving you directions to follow. I'm giving you limitations and you have to make the decisions. And so then that way the students can learn eventually to create their own limitations and create their challenges. So that's just another kind of strategy that you can take back immediately into your classroom and use. And so going back to this notion, this core philosophy of mine, this core value of mine, everyone is uniquely creative. If I believe that, that's going to drive my choices in my classroom. If you don't believe it, if that's something that you're kind of like throwing your hands up and saying, you know, that's just not how I see it, then you're going to make different choices. And so that's why I would say that if you are thinking about that shift, you're thinking about like, oh, I really want to allow choice. I really want to think about teaching for artistic behaviors. Then you really have to like get clear about why you want to do that. And so for me, it was always like, well, if everyone is uniquely creative, I don't want to do something that's going to really hold students back. I want to try to create this environment that will allow students to have more choice, to have more of an authentic voice in their work. So if you believe that choice is only going to lead to chaos and to a free-for-all, and that you know, it's just going to be just a big mess, then yeah, it's going to be a big mess, because again, that idea of a self-fulfilling prophecy. So it's going to take a conscious decision to think about like, this is my core value. How can I now make these decisions based on that? If everyone is uniquely creative, I can then start to design experiences. I can design my classroom to help that. And yes, I'm designing it. I still am the master of the space. So I get to decide like, okay, today we're going to focus on, everyone's going to do this little thing just to learn this, or well, today I'm going to do a quick demonstration about how to use these materials, or we're going to talk about developing an idea. And so I'm still making those decisions. It's not just like, okay, everyone come in and start working. I still am creating experiences that help me help the students achieve the standards and their own goals, their own ideas. So again, I, as the teacher, am designing that. And I just gave you several strategies that can help you go back to your classroom and at least start to dabble and not give up that control and not totally have it as a free-for-all. So anyway, I hope you got something out of this. I hope it got you thinking about what your core value is, what your kind of basic belief, your philosophy of education really is. So if you've ever had to write a philosophy of education, see if you can boil it down to one sentence or one short phrase that can really be the driving force. So again, look at your teaching. You know, are you all about control and, you know, dictating what the students are doing? Is it about following directions? Here's the thing, following directions is not a standard. I've looked all over, you know, well, at least the national standards, maybe it is in your state, but national standards, no, it's not a standard. So assessing students because they're following directions, now using materials safely, using them effectively, yeah, that is a standard. So think about that, that you can still have your students meeting standards, you can still teach them materials, techniques, art history, all that kind of stuff. So that I just kind of want to leave you with this notion that discipline-based art education is not the opposite of choice-based. They actually can coexist. I can still give students choices, but I can still teach them, you know, production. That's the materials and the technique. I can teach them art history, and I can show them different artists. Talking about art criticism, we can talk about, you know, looking at art and creating art and thinking about composition and the elements and principles. I can still teach all that. And then aesthetics, I can still teach all that, have that as components in my curriculum. But I can also give them choice. I think that notion of a project, which is something that ended up getting tagged on, and it became an easy package for art teachers to sort of think about and also to promote and to like show administrators and other teachers like, oh, this is what we're doing. So anyway, just kind of think about what is your core value? What is your philosophy? And can you create a experience, a classroom, a studio that will allow your students to have more choice and more of a voice in their artwork? So anyway, if you have any questions, please, please pop them into the comments, chat, or whatever it's called. And I'll try to get back to you. I'll try to respond to you. The other thing is that you can reach out to me. I'm on social media. I also have a website. You can find my email address on my website if you want to email me. And yeah, I really appreciate you taking time out of your busy schedule. I hope you have been enjoying the conference. And anyway, thank you so much. And like I said, if there's anything that you need, reach out to me and I'll try to answer any questions that you have. So anyway, thank you so much. I appreciate you being here.